Good morning, Cornerstone. And if this is your first time joining us for worship, we welcome you. My name is Jeff. I'm one of the pastors of Cornerstone. And it's just wonderful to think that we're all gathered at the same time, at this time, to worship the Lord Jesus Christ, in the sense to express our worship through song that we can sing along with our praise leaders, through praying together, and also to learn from God's word. Together. It's great. You know, we don't know what the future, immediate future will bring, but we know Him who brings the future. Would you please join me in prayer as we begin our time of worship together in this way? Let's pray. Have mercy on us, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out our transgressions, wash us thoroughly from our iniquities, and cleanse us from our sin. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and lead us in the way everlasting. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. To worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. To worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. To bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. T'was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be, as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God, who called me here below, will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Carl. Hope everyone's doing well in the time of COVID-19. I'll be doing today's scripture reading from Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14 through chapter 5, verse 10. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. For every high priest chosen from among men is appointed to act on behalf of men, in relation to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He can deal gently with ignorant and wayward, since he himself is beset with weakness. Because of this, he is obligated to offer sacrifice for his own sins, just as he does for those of the people. And no one takes the honor for himself, but only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So as Christ did not exalt himself to be made of high priest, he was appointed by him who said to him, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you." As he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications and loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered, and being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him, being designated by God a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. The word of the Lord.
We continue our series through the book of Hebrews, or we could say the letter of Hebrews. And this text that was just read to us is from the end of chapter 4 into chapter 5 and deals with how we are to hold fast to the great high priest, being Jesus our Lord. And today, you've probably heard maybe a lot of conspiracy theories going around about the coronavirus and its origin, how it could have been started. And I bring this up because there was a conspiracy theory back in the time of World War II about Winston Churchill and how he was forced to make a very painful choice at one point. Now, again, I just say that this is a conspiracy theory. It's never been proven to be true. But the theory claims that the British Secret Service had broken the Nazi code and learned that they were going to raid a bomb a small town called Coventry, and they informed Churchill about this just hours before the raid. And so he had two alternatives. Number one is he could have evacuated the town and saved hundreds of lives from being bombed, but then at the same time informing the Germans that they had broken the code. Or two, take no action and then allow hundreds of people to possibly die due to the bombing, but then keep the information flowing and then potentially save many more lives in the long run. Well, Churchill had to choose, and he chose to take no action, as the conspiracy theory goes. Well, I share this today because this conspiracy theory addresses a real issue that our government officials are trying to deal with now. Keep people at home to limit the spread of the coronavirus, or begin to open businesses and schools to get the society and the economy going again. Either choice has real risks for people's lives. To stay at home creates a huge financial difficulty on a large percentage of our population, and which then puts people's lives at risk. But on the other hand, to open up businesses and schools puts people's lives at risk as well. So this decision is very difficult and extremely complex. So whatever our leaders decide could result in more people dying, either by the coronavirus or by other factors. And the point is that we look to our leaders for guidance and wisdom and help, especially in these times of crisis. And I bring this up because the author of Hebrews states at the very beginning of our text, from this text in chapters 4 and 5, that Jesus is our great high priest. Now, many of us, this will not resonate because we have no experience or knowledge of a high priest. But for those with a Jewish background, the high priest was their spiritual and, in many ways, the political leader of their people. And even during the time of Jesus, if you remember, the Romans ruled and occupied the land of Israel. But the high priest was still a huge influence over the Jewish people. I mean, remember, who was Jesus taken to immediately after he was arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane? He was taken to Caiaphas, the high priest. And the other religious leaders then were with him. Hebrews was written to Christians with a Jewish background. Sometime before Rome or the Romans destroyed Jerusalem and therefore the Jewish temple in Jerusalem. Now let's keep this in mind and read again Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14. Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. Our text today focuses on the truth that Jesus is the great high priest and what that means for us today, us who follow him. You see, Jesus is not only our priest, which means he's the one who cares for us and goes to God on our behalf. Jesus is not only our high priest, which means he's the head of all priests, but Jesus is said to be the great high priest. And no other priest in the Bible, in the scriptures, is described as great. Only Jesus is described that way. And this is because he far surpasses all the other high priests mentioned in the scriptures. Here's some background to help us to understand this about the high priest. See, only the high priest could enter the holiest place in Israel's temple, in Jerusalem. And it was called, this holiest place is called the Holy of Holies. And it was separated by the rest of the temple by this large, thick curtain or veil, we could call it. And it contained, the Holy of Holies contained the Ark of God, although also known as the Ark of the Covenant or the mercy seat. This is the place where God had chosen to reveal himself, his presence to Israel. And so no one dared to even look at the Ark of God or even be in the same room. It was just too dangerous. And those who had even touched the Ark in the past had died on the spot. There's stories of this in the Old Testament scriptures. So by God's direction, only the high priest was allowed to go into the Holy of Holies, and only once a year would he do this, and only with the blood of an animal sacrifice to cover his own sins as well as the sins of the people of Israel. And even then, what's interesting is the stories say that the other priests would tie a rope around the waist of the high priest before he'd go into the Holy of Holies in case he happened to die in the presence of God for some reason. And they didn't want to risk their own lives to go in and get him. So they would be able to drag and pull him out without entering the Holy of Holies. You see, being the high priest in Israel was an awesome responsibility, but also an awesome privilege. So now listen again to the description of Israel's high priest given to us in Hebrews chapter 5, verses 1 through 4. For every high priest chosen from among men is appointed to act on behalf of men in relation to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He can deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is beset with weakness. Because of this, he is obligated to offer sacrifice for his own sins, just as he does for those of the people. And no one takes this honor for himself, but only when called by God, just as Aaron was. Now, as God chose Aaron, who was the brother of Moses, to be the first high priest, so only Aaron's descendants could serve as priests. And from those descendants, from those priests, a high priest could be chosen. And like Aaron was chosen to be the first high priest, God chose Jesus to be the great high priest. And then this is because Jesus is better than Aaron or any of the other high priests that ever came before. And this is because Jesus didn't go into a man-made temple. He came from heaven. Jesus didn't bring with him the blood of animal sacrifice. Jesus shed his own blood. And he didn't go Jesus didn't go before an Ark of the Covenant, which only represented God's presence, but Jesus, he himself, and was and still is the very presence of God in the flesh. And so this is why Jesus is truly the great high priest, because he is the Son of God, and being the very presence of God himself, and shedding his own blood that covers the sins of all mankind, not just the Israelite people. Jesus truly is the great high priest, and he is your great high priest if you trust in and follow him as Lord. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. So there are three things today in today's text that we are encouraged to do in response to this truth that Jesus is the great high priest. And the first we see right here in the verse I just read, hold fast our confession. What does this mean? Our confession is our belief in the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the confession by which we are saved, that Jesus is Lord. It is the confession that Jesus is the Son of God, come in the flesh. It is the confession of our own sin and God's forgiveness made possible through the death and resurrection of Jesus. It is the confession of our hope in the return of Jesus to come and judge the living and the dead, and then establish the new heaven and new earth. The Apostles' Creed, for example, is one ancient statement of this confession. We are to hold fast to this confession of faith, and this means to grip it tight, to not let go. Why are we not to let go? Well, because earlier we were warned by the author of Hebrews of the terrible consequences of unbelief and disobedience in chapters 3 and chapters 4. And we may think that then we would need to strive to earn God's favor. We got to strive harder, right? Strive to be better. Strive to obey his commandments. But as we learned in chapter 4 last Sunday, we are to strive, but we are to strive to enter God's rest. And this is the Sabbath rest of Jesus Christ, because his work is finished. It's done. And so his rest becomes our rest. And that salvation that he gives us and has achieved comes to all of us who follow him as Lord. We do not have to strive for it or earn it. No, he did it all. It's finished. But you and I sin when we don't rest in the work of Jesus. When we fail to believe that Jesus, the great high priest, did the necessary work to cover our sins. When we don't hold fast to our confession, if we're not holding fast to it, then if we're not holding fast, we will just kind of drift away from that confession and from the Lord Jesus. This is exactly what chapter 2, verse 1 warned us back a few messages ago. So hold fast to our confession, brothers and sisters, especially for those of us who are now suffering in some way. Maybe it's physically or mentally or emotionally or relationally or financially, especially during this time. Suffering can lead you and me to wonder if God really cares about us. Hold fast to Jesus. Stay the course. Persevere in faith. Which leads us to the second way we are encouraged to respond. Since Jesus is the great high priest, we are to obey through suffering. We see this in Hebrews chapter 5, verses 8 through 10. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him, being designated by God a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. Melchizedek is dealt with in chapter 7 of Hebrews. So we'll wait until then to get into who he is and learn about him. So let's focus on the part that says Jesus became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him. And also we read in that same, what we just read, is that Jesus learned obedience through what he suffered. And also in chapter 4, verse 15 of our text, it says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who is in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin." Jesus, the great high priest, suffered as we suffer now. This is an amazing truth. He was tempted like we are tempted, yet without sin. This doesn't mean that Jesus, as it says in the text, learned to obey through what he suffered. No, because Jesus was and is perfectly holy. He always obeys. But because he was also perfectly human, he learned the experience, or learned by experience, what it was like to obey in the context and while suffering himself. And in a sense, it expanded his experience of obedience. Now, Jesus was tempted in every way we are. And because he was made perfect, meaning he was God made in the flesh, or God became flesh, he never sinned. He always obeyed, because to disobey would go against his very identity of who he was. He wouldn't disobey. Who is Jesus? Well, he is, as our text says, the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him. See, the hardest times for you and me to obey is the times of pain and suffering and temptation. Christian professor Matt Proctor once shared about his 5-year-old Carl and his 3-year-old named Conrad, and how they loved it when he dressed like they did. And his sons would put on jeans and a blue t-shirt, and then they would ask him to do the same, to put on jeans and a blue t-shirt. And when he did, they said, "Look, Dad, we're the same. And when Matt played living room football with his boys, Conrad, his 3-year-old, would not let him play standing because he was just too big. So he insisted that Matt would get down on his knees. And then when Matt was down at eye level, Conrad put his hand on his dad's shoulder and said, "There, see, Dad, we're the same. And that summer, Matt shares that he scraped his leg while he was working on his house. And then a little later, Conrad fell and scraped his leg. And then he pointed at his dad's leg with the scab on it. And then he put in at his own scrape. And he said, "Look, Dad, it's the same. Well, here's the point. You see, God himself has felt what we feel in our suffering. When he became man, when Jesus became man, the God the Son, he got down, in a sense, at eye level, and he experienced what it's like to be tired and sick. He knows what it's like to hurt and to bleed. On the cross, Jesus experienced the pain of betrayal and loss, and even more so, a break in the fellowship with God the Father for the first time in all eternity. In our suffering, we may be tempted to say, "God, you have no idea what I'm going through. You have no idea how bad I'm hurting inside." But God responds saying, "Yes, I do." And he points to your wounds and his own wounds, and he says, "Look, it's the same. And he says, "I know how you feel. I have been there. And I am with you now. I care, and I can help." Jesus, our great high priest. You see, you and I experience God's presence and power and salvation when we obey through our suffering, during our suffering. And this is because then we experience his comfort to us. We experience his presence and his comfort when we trust him and obey. Our trust leads, in a sense, to obedience through suffering. Jesus obeyed during his great suffering, and he calls you and me to do so as well, to hold fast and trust in him during our times of great pain and suffering. Since Jesus is the great high priest, so we hold fast to our confession and we obey through suffering. And lastly, we see here, pray with confidence. We pray with confidence because there's no leader that can help and support us like Jesus. Listen to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. We can pray with confidence because mercy and grace is what we will find at the throne of God. And we're not going to find rebuke or judgment. No, mercy and grace. The throne of grace truly does provide grace that we need to help us in our time of need. Our King will give us the resources that we need to face our trials, to bear up under our sufferings, to wage this ongoing battle that you and I have against temptation and sin. And he will give to us gladly, willingly, because of the sacrifice of his son, Jesus, who is our great high priest. You know, there's a story that illustrates this. In her book, The God Who Hung on the Cross, journalist Ellen Vaughn tells the story of how the gospel came to this small little village in Cambodia. And in September of 1999, Pastor Toi Sung, which isn't really his, it's not his real name, traveled to Kampong Thom province in northern Cambodia. And throughout that isolated area, most of the villagers were Buddhists and Spiritists. Very few had even heard of Christianity. But to Sung's very much surprise, he arrived in one small rural village in northern Cambodia, and the people warmly embraced him and his message about Jesus. And when he asked the villagers about their openness to the gospel, an old woman shuffled forward and grasped his hands. She said, "We have been waiting for you for 20 years. And then she told him the story of the mysterious God who hung on the cross. So the story goes, in the 1970s, the Khmer Rouge, the brutal communist-led regime, took over Cambodia, and it destroyed everything in its path. When the soldiers finally made it to this small rural village in northern Cambodia in 1979, they immediately rounded up all the villagers and forced them to dig their own graves. So after the villagers had finished digging their graves, they prepared themselves to die. So some screamed to Buddha, others screamed to these demon spirits or to their ancestors. But one of the women started to cry for help based on a childhood memory that she had, a story her mother had told her about a God who had hung on a cross. And so the woman prayed loudly to this unknown God on a cross. And surely if this God, she was thinking, had known suffering, he would have compassion for their situation, for them. And suddenly, her solitary cry became a great cry as the entire village heard what she was saying and joined her in praying to this God who had hung on the cross and suffered. And as they continued facing their own graves, waiting to be killed, and crying out, weeping out loudly, it slowly, though, over a period of time, turned to more quiet crying. And then there was this eerie silence that hung in the muggy air of that day. And slowly, they dared to turn around to face their captors. And that, to their surprise, they discovered that the soldiers were gone. They'd left. And as the old woman finished telling her story, she told Pastor Sung that ever since that humid day 20 years ago, the villagers had been waiting for someone to come and finish telling them the story, the rest of the story about this God who hung on the cross. And then he came and shared about Jesus. See, these Cambodians prayed to an unknown God who hung on the cross, and Jesus saved them. How much more so that we who know Jesus and believe that he is the Son of God, the great high priest, can have confidence to pray. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Brothers and sisters, pray with confidence. God is willing. God is able to help us in our time of need. When life is hard and we feel like giving up, don't. Stay the course. Hold fast to our confession, because Jesus is the Son of God. Obey through suffering, because we know that Jesus suffers with us. He has suffered and experienced everything we experience now. And pray with confidence, because Jesus is our Savior. He is our salvation and will give mercy and grace in our time of need. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you who are the great high priest, you who are our leader, we look to you now in our time of need. We know, Lord, that we need you to enable us in your spirit to do what is right, to think of others rather than just always thinking of ourselves. To, Lord, forgive us of our sinfulness that we constantly struggle with this side of eternity. Lord, we look forward to the day that you will return and come to judge the living and the dead, because we have confidence in your salvation, in your work that you have accomplished once and for all who love you and follow you in faith. Lord Jesus, we pray for opportunities to share this truth as Pastor Sung did with those Cambodians. Lord, that we would share this wonderful truth that you are the great high priest, that you are our Savior and Lord, Redeemer and friend with everyone in our lives. Give us opportunities to do so, and that we can spread the hope that this world can have in you, Lord Jesus. We pray in your name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, be safe this week.
Let us respond in worship, and let us sing of how great Jesus Christ is, that he is our high priest who came here in love.
My name is graven on
on his hands, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there who made an end of all my sin. Because a sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. To look on him and pardon me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, praise the one risen Son of God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, praise the one risen Son of God. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One in himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God. With Christ my Savior and my God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Son of God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, praise the one risen Son of God.
Good afternoon, Cornerstone. Thank you for joining us on this Sunday service. My name is Katie, and I will be giving the announcements for this week. So let's start with the verse of the month. Let's read it together on three. One, two, three. Guard your steps when you go to the house of God. To draw near to listen is better than to offer the sacrifice of fools, for they do not know that they are doing evil. Ecclesiastes 5:1. Okay, now going into announcements. The first announcement is for the missionary of the week. This week, our missionaries are Cindy and Robert, who are serving in the Philippines. Let's pray for their continued safety and opportunities to make disciples. Next announcement, we're going to continue to pray for the Muslims during Ramadan. We encourage everyone to pray daily for the Muslims during Ramadan, which is ending May 23rd. So if you're interested, please contact Pastor Jeff for information, and daily items will be provided as guidance for how to pray. If you need prayer, we now have a way for you to share your prayer requests online. So if you want our leadership to pray for you for something, you can go online, go on our website, and submit your requests online. You can find the image below saying need prayer. After worship today at 1 p.m., you can also go on our website to find a link for a meeting to hang out with each other so we can just catch up and hang out, encourage one another, and eat lunch together online. Just as a reminder, we still have Sunday Bible classes at 10 a.m. every Sunday. We have adult classes taught by Pastor Jeff. We have the 10th to 12th grade class taught by Nathan, and the 7th to 9th grade class taught by Pastor Paul. So if you're interested in that, you can check the website for the links on Sunday mornings for you to join. Lastly, life groups are now online and they will be starting next week. We highly encourage everyone to join a life group during this time to stay connected with each other. And we also use this time to discuss the application of Sunday's message. So please go online to sign up for the spring and summer cycle, and it will begin next week. That is it for today. So let me close this in prayer. Father God, thank you for another week, for your goodness to continue to show, and pray that we can continue to keep our eyes on you and to live a Christ-centered life. And for us to be sensitive to your calling and how you're moving in our lives. And all this I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. That's it for today. Have a good day. So give us clean hands and give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls.